Macmillan Audio presents On Fascism, 12 Lessons from American History by Matthew C. MacWilliams. Read for you by Kevin Stillwell.
When fascism came into power, most people were unprepared, both theoretically and practically. They were unable to believe that man could exhibit such propensities for evil, such lust for power, such disregard for the rights of the weak, or such yearning for submission. Eric Fromm, Escape from Freedom. Fellow citizens, we cannot escape history. Abraham Lincoln, December 1, 1862. Author note. If you love the promise of America and our Enlightenment aspirations as much as I do, coming to terms with our failures and confronting their root cause is an essential step toward rejecting authoritarianism and attaining a robust e pluribus unum. Out of many, one, steeped in the power of equality, diversity, and democracy. That is the America I seek, and the reason behind writing this audiobook. Those who won our independence believed that fear breeds repression, that repression breeds hate, that hate menaces stable government. Justice Louis Brandeis, Whitney v. California, 1927. Please, I can't breathe. George Floyd, Final Words, 2020. Index of American Authoritarian Attitudes. Democracy. 46% of Americans are inconsistent supporters of democracy and democratic institutions. 34% of Americans agree it is more important to follow the will of the people today than the principles laid out in the U.S. Constitution. 31% of Americans agree that having a strong leader who does not have to bother with Congress and elections is a good way of governing the United States. 24% of Americans agree with limiting the freedoms of the press and media in the United States. 13% of Americans agree that if it is necessary to protect our country, the president should limit the voice and vote of opposition parties. Othering. 30% of Americans agree with the statement, "I often find myself fearful of other people, of other races." 16% of Americans agree an ideal society requires some groups to be on top and others to be on the bottom. 14% of Americans agree some groups of people are simply inferior to other groups. Aggression and threat. 44% of Americans agree that increasing racial, religious, and ethnic diversity represents a threat to the security of the United States. 23% of Americans agree that sometimes other groups must be kept in their place. 15% of Americans think that those who disagree with the majority are a threat to the interest of the country. Racism and sexism. 31% of white Americans say black Americans are somewhat to very violent. 28% of Americans agree that many women are actually seeking special favors, such as hiring policies that favor them over men, under the guise of asking for equality. 26% of white Americans say black Americans are somewhat to very lazy. Introduction. Pogo knows. We have met the enemy, and he is us. Pogo. The Index of American Authoritarian Attitudes is my tool for estimating the gap between the universal values, beliefs, and attitudes Americans are reputed to hold and our actual commitment to democratic principles and ideas. The results are eye-popping. While the Declaration of Independence says that all men are created equal, 14% of Americans think that some groups of people are simply inferior to others. We assume that the Constitution and the rule of law are essential governing precepts, Yet 34% of Americans say it is more important to follow the will of the people today than the constitutional principles on which the rule of law stands. 31% of Americans agree that having a strong leader who does not have to bother with Congress and elections is a good way to govern the United States. And 13% of Americans say we should junk the Bill of Rights and let the president limit the voice and vote of opposition parties if the country is threatened in any way. The data in the index comes from national surveys taken in the United States between 2016 and 2017. They reveal attitudes that are inconsistent with what so many know or think they know about our fellow Americans. For example, 26% of white Americans think black Americans are somewhat to very lazy. 27% are more likely to say Hispanic Americans do not share my values. 36% think Muslim Americans are somewhat to very violent. And when it comes to equality of opportunity, 42% oppose the notion that all groups in America should have an equal chance to succeed, or feign neutrality on the issue. How do we square these opinions with the story of American exceptionalism and the values that ostensibly anchor it? We must start by recognizing that these findings are a symptom of something deeper, an underlying disposition that has been with America throughout its history. That disposition is authoritarianism. Approximately 18% of Americans are highly disposed to authoritarianism. Another 23% or so are attitudinally just one step below them on the authoritarian scale. When these two positions are taken together, roughly 4 out of every 10 Americans tends to favor authority, obedience, and uniformity over freedom, independence, and diversity. A more detailed explanation of how authoritarianism is estimated is discussed in Appendix 3. When fear or circumstance, inflamed by the rhetorical misrepresentations of a would-be autocrat, activate the authoritarianism latent in these Americans, many of them will sacrifice liberty for security. They will side with the strongman and other purveyors of tyrannical majoritarianism, choosing to escape from freedom rather than defend it. Their activated, unyielding support for a strongman can become a new identity that provides a sense of belonging, generates social and material benefits, and delineates group boundaries for its members to patrol, enforce, and defend. In its most virulent expression, when the benefits of division and othering, identifying a particular group as intrinsically different and potentially threatening, exceed those of unity of people and purpose, this process of group identification, aggression, and protection can spiral into fascism. Our fervent belief in the myth of American exceptionalism persuades us that we are uniquely immune to the activation of authoritarianism. Some of us contend that we are different from people in every other country in the world. We are not. To understand one of the root causes of polarization in America today, set aside the fairy tale story of American history. Our ancestors were not magically cleansed of their disposition to authoritarianism upon alighting on the shore of Plymouth Plantation, being dragged off a slave ship in Savannah Harbor, or disembarking on Ellis Island. Fascism may be a 20th century foundling, birthed by Mussolini's Fasci di Combattimento. But its taproot, authoritarianism, is a disposition that is as old as humanity itself. Like smallpox and other old-world diseases that ravaged the native populations in the New World, authoritarianism migrated with the first settlers to America. Since America's founding, there's been a perpetual tug of war between our aspiration toward a more perfect union and the authoritarian impulses that have coursed through our polity and politics. These two competing forces, and the differing visions of America they yield, have been with the nation since the founding. Take, as one example, the Civil War period, 1861 through 1865. Abraham Lincoln represents the more enlightened view of equality and fundamental human rights. "I am naturally anti-slavery," Lincoln wrote in 1864. If slavery is not wrong, nothing is wrong. I cannot remember when I did not so think and feel. The antithesis of Lincoln at the time was Roger Taney, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court from 1836 to 1864. His decision in the Dred Scott case, which decided that black people, enslaved or free, were not entitled to U.S. citizenship, exemplified authoritarian othering in action. Writing for the court's majority in Dred Scott v. Sanford, Taney asserted that blacks are beings of an inferior order, so far inferior that they had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. To Chief Justice Taney, the equality for all principle embedded in the Declaration of Independence was limited to whites. At least Taney did not pay lip service to the Declaration's enlightened aspirations, as so many Americans do today. The ongoing tug of war between those, like Taney, who are disposed to authoritarianism, and those, like Lincoln, who are not, courses through our history. It overwhelms the better angels of our nature and produces the dirty laundry at the bottom of America's historical hamper. It provokes America's ugliness and too often produces the shameful stories that stain our history. And it reveals our predilection for what James Madison called the infection of violent passions. In Federalist 63, the 85 Federalist Papers were written by Madison, Hamilton, and Jay in support of ratification of the U.S. Constitution. Madison warned, "There are particular moments in public affairs when the people, stimulated by some irregular passion or some illicit advantage, or misled by the artful misrepresentations of interested men, may call for measures which they themselves will afterwards be the most ready to lament and condemn." American history is littered with these Madisonian moments, times in which the rights of minorities, or whatever group was being othered, were trampled. Events when the rule of law was bent to justify lawbreaking. For example, the 1919 through 20 Palmer raids, which we will examine in Lesson 8. Periods when almost any means or act was judged acceptable if it led to the attainment of a desired end, no matter how antithetical the end was to the ideals of the Constitution and the rule of law. What a nation believes about its past is at least as important as what the past actually was. Benjamin Carter Hett, The Death of Democracy. The Alien and Sedition Acts of 1798, the Indian Removal Act of 1830, Chinese exclusion, the internment of Japanese Americans, and the return of Jim Crow under the guise of law and order are just a few of these moments of which Madison warned. These Madisonian moments are not historical relics. In today's America, where an increasing number of us are bowling alone, to use the term political scientist Robert Putnam applies to a United States in which civic organizations are in steep decline, hate groups have increased 30% from just 4 years ago, and now number more than 1,000. They are an unparalleled sector of uncivil civic growth in 21st century America. Our nation's egalitarian democratic aspirations have always competed for supremacy with a darker, pathological tradition rooted in authority, obedience, and the hegemonic enforcement of majoritarian interests and norms. This is a journey that began at our founding. Who are the we in We the People? What does all mean in all men are created equal? In the beginning, all and we were exclusive and codified. They referred to white male property owners, and no one else. Yet the Declaration of Independence and the preamble to the Constitution are certainly not dry legal recitations of rights. They are soaring revolutionary proclamations, audacious statements of hope and aspiration that are the responsibility of each generation to protect and perfect. The odds of reaching a more perfect union and living up to our democratic ideals improve if we remove our blinders and examine the history too many refuse to acknowledge. That important journey begins by going to the core of America's origin myth. The notion that Americans are some special breed of people, and debunking it. Our inheritance may be unique, but we as a people are not. Not even in the beginning. As the turn-of-the-century sociologist Samuel G. Smith noted in his speech at the first International Eugenics Congress, held in London in 1912, as to the criminally born, England knew what to do with them. She sent them to America to found the first families of New York or Virginia. You might be disposed to dismiss the latent authoritarianism residing in our country and its repeated expression throughout our history as anomalous, the proverbial exceptions that prove our fundamental commitment to equality. You might argue that throughout history, the Enlightenment ideals at the core of our democracy have always prevailed. And according to most American history textbooks, you would be more or less right. But have these ideals been secured, or just temporarily won? Is American history moving inexorably toward a more perfect union, as sociologist Gunnar Myrdal and political scientist Lewis Hartz maintained in the mid-20th century? Or is our future less certain? Are the voting rights of women, blacks, Asians, Hispanics, and Native Americans safe? Or are they at risk today? Is the safety of Jews and Muslims ensured or not? Was the separate but equal doctrine definitively overturned by Brown v. Board of Education? Or has it morphed into something just as destructive? Was Jim Crow extinguished? Or has it been replaced by something new and just as harmful? And at the center of these and other pressing questions are American democracy and its constitutionally protected institutions as robust and safe as many of us assume? Consider the evidence before us. In the last few years, many Trump administration nominees to federal district and circuit courts have refused under oath in Senate Judiciary Committee hearings to affirm the landmark 1954 Supreme Court ruling in Brown versus the Board of Education. At the time, the High Court ruled 9-0 in its favor. If today's judicial appointees can't be relied upon to vocally repudiate the racist construct of separate but equal, then every precedent, every legal advancement toward a more perfect union is now on the chopping block. In 1989, after the Berlin Wall fell and the Cold War ended, political observers, led by American philosopher Francis Fukuyama, proclaimed that the end of history was nigh. Democracy had defeated communism. According to Fukuyama, free market liberalism and globalism, tethered to democratic national and supranational institutions, were evolving into the final form of human government. No process existed that could take democracies backward. Today, that declaration seems farcical. But even then, in the irrational exuberance following the fall of communism, Fukuyama should have known better. Because a core lesson from history, acknowledged by political philosophers since the days of Athens and Sparta, is that democracy is fragile. The founders of the United States knew this lesson well. As future President John Quincy Adams wrote in a letter in 1814, "Democracy never lasts long. It soon wastes, exhausts, and murders itself."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.